Welcome, everyone. My name is Haley Lott, and I'm so happy that you're here watching the Global Meditation Summit. I'm going to be your host today, and I want to show you guys how to have your own at-home practice and then how to receive all the benefits from your life. Today, we have Valerie joining us, the Connection Coach, and I'm so excited that you're here, Valerie, and thank you so much for being here.
Thank you so much for having me, Haley. And I love what you're doing. And I think this is a huge, important tool to support people in developing.
Yes, I agree with you. And I want to talk a little bit about your website, vdacoaching.com. If anyone's interested, I'll mention it at the end of the interview as well. But you are the Connection Coach. Like I said, what does that mean to you? And how does mindfulness play a role in connection for you?
Yeah, that's a great question. So the Connection Coach for me is just something that when I was rebranding myself 2 years ago, I've been a coach for almost 2 decades, and it's evolved as I've evolved. And everything, however it's evolved, the one common thread has been connection in my point of view. And I believe that connection, relationship ultimately is what I'm talking about. Relationships are things that unless you go to school for psychology or anything like that, we're not really taught to have healthy relationships. And so we're in constant relationship with everything, constant connection. So whether that's with our own body or our money or our career or our intimate partners or our friendships or our families, anything and everything. And so what I really support people in doing is to really become aware of the who they are now, right? And recognizing that maybe that some old patterns and beliefs have been showing up to this new relationship, but it's an upgraded version. So unless they unwire those aspects of themselves in order to rewire to what they are now, they just can oftentimes fall back to same old patterns. So that's what I really want to support people in doing, is recognizing that as you upgrade your computer and you evolve and grow, and so you up-level your life, and the way that we do that is consciously through our connections.
Interesting. I love that. And I think that everything you're saying is so true. I mean, we have connection to everything, and that's such a big part of our life. And I also feel that so many people are lacking connection. And I also feel it too in my own relationships. When I am feeling disconnected or I'm feeling just off, it doesn't feel good. And that's something we all crave, is connection with each other, connection with the environment, connection with our own consciousness. So it's really cool that, you're doing that work and, being able to help so many people while you do the work as well.
Thank you. Thank you. And, just leading into kind of what you're offering and what you're collecting from many different people and many different point of views of how to interpret as well as connect with something like meditation and mindfulness is, it's really important because that in that connection with self, it really allows for this beautiful spaciousness in order for us to really pause and become aware of all parts of ourselves, right? So we have our thought body, we have our feeling body, we have our sensation body, we have our different aspects of ourselves that are showing up in each moment. And so in that spaciousness, in meditation, we can connect with all parts of ourselves and then learn to befriend them, learn to really not to be afraid of even the silly or horrible or threatening thoughts that come through, or even the feelings that don't feel good. And that allows us to be able to soften and to just sit in a place of greater ease.
Yes. I mean, that's totally how I feel about consciousness too, is that it does bring this greater ease to your life. It allows you to soften, just like you said. And it's so important. I mean, mindfulness can be so important in relationships, because when your relationship with yourself is off, then your relationships with others just tend to kind of get out of whack as well.
Yeah.
And so how has mindfulness played a role in your life? Do you have your own mindfulness practice, and how big of a role does it play?
Yeah, I do. And quite honestly, as I evolve, so does that. And years ago when I started to meditate, I was about 20 when I got involved. Well, I was probably about 23, I'd say, when I actually started meditating. For a long time, many, many years, it was a have to, and it was structured, and it was like everything was exactly the same, and it was very rigid, and it was about perfecting. And And then I remember later in life when I was about 31, I was very into Kundalini yoga, which is, they have something called sadhana. So for 2.5 hours every day for 2.5 years, I did this religiously. Like, so it's 2.5 hours long. It starts at 4 o'clock in the morning. And I can remember the last 6 months, I would be crawling to my mat. It would take everything in me to get there. And I would be falling asleep and I just couldn't do it. And I didn't feel any joy, zero. And I finally just stopped. I stopped it all. And then I created this new belief inside of me that meditation is personal. It's something that is, it, as I evolve, it evolves. I also gave myself permission to have 5 tools or even more in my back pocket of ways that I wanted to connect with spirit, because that's ultimately what it was, is to me, pausing like that is a way for me to plug in. And quite honestly, you know, growing up when I was younger and living in an environment where I didn't really feel connected, I didn't feel like I belonged to my family. I didn't really feel connected with people in my life at all. I always felt weird and off, and I felt more connected with the stars in the sky, literally, and the trees, literally. And when I allow that pause to be with self in whatever that is, and that could be actually sitting and lighting a candle and or picking angel cards and then just looking at the cards and letting energy through. It could be focusing on a certain mantra. It could be playing music and allow my body to just naturally sway. It could literally be going on a meditative walk. But whatever I do actually practice, oftentimes, not always, but oftentimes, there is this intention. And when I say intention, I just set the tone for the for my focus. So I bring my focus to something. Now that could be my breath. Like I said, it could be a mantra. It could be a feeling. It could also be that on my meditative walk, my focus is just finding beauty. But oftentimes it's either to bring me to a state of feeling a good, higher, more anabolic, higher vibration of feeling. So if I practice that for 15 minutes a day, that will become more of my norm and I'll get more comfortable with that. Or I bring it to a neutral. So that could be focusing on the fan buzzing in my bedroom. It could be focusing just on my breath. So it's not necessarily initiating anything really big. It's more so coming to a place of neutrality. The reason why I tend to do that is, or when I find that I naturally do that, is because if I'm having a really hard time for whatever reason, maybe I'm sifting through some really big contrast in my life. Maybe I'm just on a downward spiral and I just can't get out of my own way. When I do sit, if I try to sit and go to and try to find a place of like joy when I'm in a place of like anxiety or depression, it's such a hard leap, and it's so hard to get from here all the way to there. And so bringing it to more of a neutral is so that helps me, because then it kind of just, it takes me to a place, instead of trying to get to a place of joy, I all of a sudden get to a place of relief or satisfaction. And that is, now I'm up the scale.
Wow. That's so beautifully said. I mean, I think that what you're saying is something everyone can relate to, especially when you, in the beginning, we're talking about how meditation was a have to. I think so many people feel that way. And that's how I felt too when I first began meditating. I mean, my mom forced us when we were young. I mean, looking back, I feel blessed, but I felt forced at the time. And then also I really, really, really like what you said about coming to a neutral space, because I completely agree with you that when you're getting in your own way, you're in this cycle and it doesn't feel good, but that joy sometimes feels, like you said, unattainable or unreachable. But if you could just, you know, think about the fan and consciously be aware of the fan and just find that inner peace in a neutral space, I think it just makes it easy, a little bit easier. Yeah. Self and for anyone to really be able to kind of tap into that.
Yeah, totally. And I would say a big thing as well to add on to that was a huge point for me that I stopped doing, that I didn't even know I was doing. So awareness is always the first step, is that, you know, our thoughts, I mean, we have over 50,000 thoughts a day. So those thoughts are going to come through. And I used to shame and judge myself a ton when I'd be like, what's my problem? Why can't I get it right? And what I notice is when I'm more in that catabolic state and I really practice neutrality, I even bring in, like, part of my intention is to practice that when my thoughts do pull to worry or that situation that was before I sat down is still there, I really invite in compassion and acceptance. I'm like, oh, there it is. Oh, it's okay. Oh, and I still love you. Oh, and I see what you're trying to do. You're trying to take me. And I just come back. I'm like, it's okay. And I don't negate it. I don't push it away. I don't make it wrong. I just acknowledge it. It's like I'm waving at it and saying, I see you, but I'm not going to pay attention to you. And I bring it back. And that's a big one for me. Yeah.
Definitely. I completely agree with you, because that's exactly how I was when I first began meditating. I was so pissed that I had all these thoughts and I was just like angry and frustrated. But then when I was able to see it as kind of like a friendly relationship and give it compassion, give these thoughts compassion, give myself compassion, then I was able to move forward and be like, okay, this is okay. Thoughts are natural. You know, I mean, and when you meditate, the thoughts are going to be there, but we can have compassion towards them instead of frustration and anger. And I think that makes your journey on on mindfulness and meditation a little bit easier, because it's not this frustrating thing anymore. It's this like loving, compassion relationship that you're creating with yourself.
Yeah. Totally. So beautiful. So beautiful. Good for you. Good for you for just staying so committed and disciplined with yourself to continue that practice. And I think that's so much what it takes. It just, you know, even if we don't believe our worth in that moment, because I know I didn't for so long, it's just like, I'm just staying committed and disciplined. Then we eventually see and reap and the benefits of it. And I know for me, it's so interesting. Even though I know it, it doesn't matter that I know it all the time. It's like right now I'm making significant change. Like I'm moving for the summer and things are changing rather quickly. And I'm just picking up and I'm in a different place all the time. So routine, which is really important for me, because I'm somebody that I actually do really well in variety. Like my everyday is very different for me. So my morning ritual is so important for me. That said, right now everything's shifting and changing. So I'm finding like my first 2 days in our new place, I didn't meditate and I just looked at my boyfriend and I was like, baby, I want to connect with spirit. Like I was like, I'm having pockets of it. But for me, just knowing that I have that space to just really drop in. And it was interesting because the first 5 minutes I noticed I was antsy. And then I was like, oh, that's right. This is what I love. It feels so good. And it's like a returning home every time. And I love it.
Mm-hmm. I feel the exact same way about the routine and getting thrown off of it. And it is kind of like returning home when it becomes a safe, loving space for you.
Yeah.
And what was your first experience with mindfulness? Do you remember it, or mindfulness or meditation? And what was it like for you?
Geez. You know, I think I was definitely like the first book I read, I remember perfectly. It was the one that I had that aha moment that, you know, that many people talk about. It was like, that was the returning home. It was like, so it was Celestine Prophecy. I was 17 years old. I picked it up and everything made sense. And it was like, for the first time, everything made sense to me. And that's when I started the path. And I really heavily got on it when I was 20 and I started to read and listen to Carolyn Mace and Marian Williamson and Tony Robbins were my main teachers back then. So consciousness and mindfulness was something that, again, I automatically was trying to perfect and get somewhere. So from 20 to 25, I was so rigid in every way. Like that's when I was severely anorexic because I was working out for like 3 hours a day and I was, workaholic and doing everything to the full extreme. And so I would say, even though I was incorporating all the stuff and listening and voraciously reading these things, I don't know if I was necessarily assimilating it and digesting it and making it my own. Again, I'm not certain that my intention behind it was of pure love. I'm sure it had to do with that. If I get this right, then I'll be good enough and lovable enough, you know, and if I could, you know, clear myself from my past, all this different stuff. And I think that as the years progressed and I had these little aha moments, like the moment I first cried in a yoga class and the moment that I would hear certain teachers say certain things like, imagine if we were spirit in human form, and or when I started to understand the chakra system. So all of these little light bulbs would go off. And I really don't think it was until about after the whole Kundalini experience. I mean, in Kundalini, I would have glorious experiences. But again, the way I was approaching it was, it was a little more self-love. But, you know, it's just been this evolution of closer and closer of, and I think, but the best part too, Haley, is like, that will only grow. Like I will only grow with deeper self-love and deeper connection with spirit. I mean, I wish I could tell you the moment, but I don't know if there was one that I could pinpoint, because it's just been this unfolding and this ecstatic, beautiful thing that continues to unfold.
Yeah, that gives me chills, because I totally resonate with that. And that's what's so beautiful about mindfulness and meditation, is that it's our own and we create it. It can be whatever we want it to be. And sometimes we make it frustrating and hard, and then, you know, we go down this path and we slowly learn and get stronger, and you know, just our horizons are expanded. And I just appreciate you sharing your journey and showing that, you know, it wasn't hard and it wasn't loving. And I mean, it was hard and it wasn't loving in the beginning. And then you're able to now transform it into something that's beautiful and something that you rely on and now that you call home. Because I think that it can be, especially for someone who's just starting out, it can be frustrating. I was totally I'm not good at this, you know, I'm not good enough to, you know, get it right. And now my practice is so different. And I make it my own, and I make it what it feels good to me. And whether that's, you know, only 5 minutes one morning or that's 20 minutes the next morning, it's all about me, and it's my time that I get to, you know, be selfish and love myself as much as I want. And spend time getting to know myself. So I appreciate you sharing that all. It's
absolutely. I think what the beautiful benefit is for me, especially, you know, sitting down and whether it's for 5 minutes or 15 minutes or 20 minutes a day is lovely. But if I don't continue to incorporate pockets throughout the day, because that's not for me personally enough. And so awareness and mindfulness, you know, whether it's when I'm, you know, biking to the store, or if I'm, you know, just cooking dinner or something like that. If I just take moments to just be aware of like the thoughts that are going through, what I've noticed is that less and less now, but majority of those thoughts that are sifting through, which is actually majority of our world, is our negative. And so if I become aware, and again, without judging or shaming, but just reframe them and shift from a place of the why not to a possibility or to a gratitude, you know, gratitude, gosh, talk about like that an elixir, like just in a finding appreciation for whatever is. And I feel like that mindfulness is probably, it's so beautiful and so big, because ultimately what we're doing is we're restructuring the cells in our body. We're in that reframing, we're actually raising our vibration. And then ultimately, because we live in an attraction-based universe, we start to get more of that vibration being met instead of the other vibration, because we live in an attraction-based universe, we'll get what we put our focus, our attention on, and everything. So it's powerful.
Yeah, it is so powerful. And then I love that you, you know, brought up kind of carrying that mindfulness and, you know, concentration on through the rest of your day, because I think that that's what's so important is, you know, you can have this great practice in the morning, but if you aren't tapping back into it, then, I mean, you know, try what works for you. But I definitely love, you know, being able to have a great morning meditation and then also being able to use that throughout the rest of my day, tapping back into it and just being really present in whatever I'm doing. I mean, mindfulness is so simple. You don't have to be, you know, I always say that you don't have to be sitting on a meditation pillow with a meditation bowl and music and candles. And even though those things are nice, they're lovely, But, you know, it really can just be while you're making dinner, focusing on the boiling water or just having awareness of what you're doing, what's going on around you. Yeah. And that's how simple that it can be.
Yeah.
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 That's what I really want to, you know, show people. And I'm so happy that you brought it up, is that it really can be just having that awareness and consciousness instead of, you know, forcing yourself to do something that doesn't serve you.
Right. You know, and it's true. And one thing that I'd love to mention, because I'm a huge proponent of obviously relationships. And I even think for people that, whether it's with their child or their intimate partner, for me, you know, this mindfulness that my boyfriend and I consciously bring this in, like and it's actually quite honestly natural. But at the same time, it's something that, we both just love it, so we'll bring it in, but we create spaciousness for just looking into each other's eyes in silence and expressing loving energy through our eyes, through our presence, and giving the gift of presence to someone, to anyone, is, as well as yourself, is like probably the greatest gift, like authentic presence. And so even finding these pockets, like obviously self is important. Start with self first, absolutely. And then see about even inviting it in to the sense with their eyes, so that being with them fully, entirely, you know, not letting your phone dictate where you're putting your energy, not letting, you know, the moment, because, and I'm not even talking about, it doesn't have to be 15 minutes where you're both like, you know, it's just like showing just like, this pause, this moment of like, wow, I want you to feel how every cell in my body is literally dancing because it's so in love with you right now. And when they feel that and you feel that from someone, it's extraordinary. It's magical.
Mm-hmm. I remember, I mean, I totally agree with that. And my feeling about it is that I think because we are so plugged into our phones and plugged into social media or plugged into whatever is going on, work, and we're always kind of in that go, go, go life, that it's like when you do give someone that time, it's so special. Because when I have that time with my family, you know, when I go to dinner with my mom or my dad, and, you know, most of the time the TV will be on, but if I get to, you know, ask for the TV to be off and just really spend that time without anything else in the way, it's so much more significant. And then yeah. Being able to look into someone's eyes without saying any words and just finding that connection. I mean, there's so often when I do that, I've come to tears because, it's just something that we don't always do. And to feel that is really, really, really beautiful. So I appreciate you brought that up because, it's something that we can all take into our relationships or take into our life, any type of relationship. Even I try to kind of do that a little bit too. You know, wherever I go, I'm not, you know, like you said, staring into the grocer's eyes for 15 minutes, but I try to make a conscious, you know, choice to stare into their eyes and make that connection because, like you said in the beginning, connection controls our world. It's all around us. It's life, and we all need it. And to be able to give that to someone is beautiful, and to be able to receive it is beautiful too.
Yeah. Yeah, and I love that you brought that up, receptivity. You know, the more that we actually allow ourselves to pause and have that connection with, call it whatever it is, spirit, God, whatever it is that you desire, that's your own beautiful, you know, belief, that that we learn to be more receptive. And in an environment and a world that we're constantly go, do, fill, you know, create all the stuff, that there's often not a lot of time for receptivity as well. As so we start to create this connection more, we start to value ourselves and value our time and say, I'm worth this time. And we start to feel that connection with something greater than us that is a part of us. And then all of a sudden, when somebody is giving you their presence, then instead of deflecting or pushing it away or not feeling or feeling uncomfortable, we can go, like, yes, because everybody, whether or not they admit it or not, everybody wants to be seen and heard, everyone. And when we give someone that gift and we're able to really receive that gift from somebody, we're giving somebody a gift by the ability to receive too. It's powerful.
Yeah, it's so powerful. It's so powerful to give, and then it is so powerful to receive as well, because it's an interesting relationship how, you know, for some, everyone's different. And for me personally, it's easier for me to give, and to receive is what's harder for me. And so, but you know, I would never say that I don't, I mean, I love the connection. I love receiving it, but it can be uncomfortable, you know, when people are, when you're making those connections. But it is really important because it goes back to the self-love and taking care of yourself and filling your cup up, so you are able to give to other people then.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, thank you for sharing that.
Absolutely.
So do you have any tips or advice that you would give someone who's just kind of, you know, starting off on this mindfulness journey themselves and is maybe feeling a little frustrated or, you know, like meditation's too hard? Do you have any tips or advice that you would give to them?
Yeah, I mean, everybody's different. And that's the one main thing that I want to say is that, you know, and find the things that fuel you, right? So for me, I know music ignites me and dance ignites me and things like angel cards ignite me, like those kind of things, and like crystals and my deities, my gods and goddesses, like those things fuel me. And so if I actually use these as a way to chew drop in, that's really helpful. Also having a sacred space that you return to, that's yours. And there can be, you know, it could be cards or pictures of people that are important to you in life, or maybe they're, you know, maybe it is a mala necklace, or maybe it's a special rock that you found that's a heart rock or something, I don't know. And having this special place that's your sacred space that you return to is really huge as well. And then having those tools in your back pocket, you know, discipline, yes, absolutely. Rigidity, that's where I think that there's a fine line. Now, it depends on the individual in the sense of that if you are somebody that's so loosey-goosey and you're kind of like, all over the place, it may do you a good of service to say, you know what, for 2 weeks, I'm going to say 5 minutes, 3 minutes, and I'm going to just sit and focus on my breath. And it, for somebody that maybe is so rigid, I would say maybe just give yourself the space and say, yes, okay, I'm going to do 5 minutes a day, and I'm going to decide before I do it, what am I going to do today? You know, is it going to be just dancing around and focusing on the music itself, or is it going to be, looking at a candle and just breathing? So I think that just really letting it be very, very personal. And then the last thing is, like we said before, is that just knowing, owning fully, like the thoughts are going to come through. Your mind is not who you are, though. Your mind is a tool. And we were never taught to train this tool. And so really, this is just an opportunity to train it. And so when those thoughts come in, to not shame them, not judge them, notice when you do, because that's just a pattern, right? And then just, you know, kind of, again, wave at it and be like, right. So before you go in, if I were to back up for a second, have an intention, have a focus, and then just do your best, not to perfect that focus, but do your best just to return to that focus.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Those are all amazing tips. Yeah, they're all amazing tips. And I think all of them are so important to, you know, kind of continue to grow and make, like you said, your practice personal. That is what it's all about. And then giving yourself that compassion and knowing that it's going to be okay, and that, you know, you're going to figure it out. Thank you so much for being here and just sharing all your knowledge. I loved learning from you, and I feel like we have a lot of similarities, and I'm glad that we connect. And I know that you have a free gift that you're planning on offering, and would you mind telling everyone about it? I watched it, but I'm excited for you to share.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much. It's called Connecting to Your Highest Self, and it's a video. And ultimately, really, it's just a reminder about that when we, and it's a tool really to just really connect with this, first of all, this glorious energy of the earth, and remembering that we are in human form, and it's such a gift to human, be in human form, because I think sometimes when we experience pains in life, that it's easy to forget that. And then to really remember that we are we are absolutely 100% a part of this glorious, infinite, possible energy that is all knowing, all giving, all abundant. And so when we give ourselves the space and the time to really basically, again, plug in, and that's what this video is like, yes, remember your greatness. Yes, remember it. And now bring it back in, bring it back in, bring it back in. And I think about that as a muscle. You know, we just keep building this muscle. And if we return to that place and we say, yes, that's what I am. I am that infinite being. I am, you know, abundant. I am, you know, possibility. And we do that again and again and again. Eventually, just like any belief and any thought that we think enough, it becomes a belief. We start to, that becomes our truth. And that's really what it is. It's just a tool to help you remind you of who you really are.
Thank you so much. I'm going to continue to watch it, and I hope that you guys all enjoy that free gift. It really is, like you said, a muscle that we have to keep working, and then for you to give us that tool and to practice that ourselves is so generous of you, and I really appreciate it. And I think that you also have an event in Costa Rica coming up, right?
Yeah, you're awesome. Yeah, thank you. I love it. I love the little face that you made. So I took a few things off the plate for the past 2 years, kind of in incubation, kind of discovering what's next. And my best friend, who I've been asking her for about 10 years, will she do a retreat with me? She's one of my most favorite yoga teachers and spiritual teachers that I know, Kristen Malia. We are leading a retreat in Costa Rica, Nosara. And it's a fabulous little beach town that's super healthy. I mean, people that go there for yoga to just be healthy and enjoy life and to surf. And that's what we're going to do. And it's all about nourishing our own selves, returning back to our greatness, and just playing for a week long. It's March 10th to the 17th. We'll be opening it officially to the public in June. But so right now we're just saying, hey, to awesome peeps, which I know the people you're inviting are going to be super awesome. It's like, we're saying, hey, come play with us ultimately. And that's really what we're going to do. So if you're interested, you can just contact me for sure at valerie@vdacoaching.com.
Awesome. Thank you so much for sharing that. And once again, thank you so much for being here and just giving us that wealth of knowledge. Thank you guys also for tuning in today and just being a part of this summit. I'm so grateful that you're here, and I will see you guys soon. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Haley.
Bye.